got an election coming up, not just locally, but we also have an election for the presidency of the United States in November. And the lady joining us on the line right now, we always love it when she takes some time. That is Congresswoman Deena Titus. Congresswoman, thank you so much for being here. How are you?
Hey, what's up, Deena?
Well, thank you for having me. I'm doing all right. I was in Washington for a couple of days last week to vote on the new relief bill, but I'm back in Las Vegas and hunkered down like everybody.
Glad you're back here, Congresswoman, because you know I certainly think you're doing a fantastic job. A lot to get to in a short period of time. Let me start by the big pink elephant in the room and get your thoughts on this situation with Stephen Horsford. When you first heard this story, what was your first reaction? What do you make of it, and do you think he should resign?
Well, Stephen called me to give me a heads up about it, and I respected him for doing that, and I appreciated it. He says it's a personal matter. It doesn't involve his professional office or anything, and he wants people to respect his privacy so he can work it out with his family, and that's what I'm doing.
And I respect that, and I understand that. I'm glad he did that to you. With that being said, do you have faith that he didn't use any of his own people to help this woman and didn't use taxpayer-funded money? I mean, is that what you're saying? Because I would imagine that's what he's saying.
Well, there's an ethics commission within the Congress, and if they think that something was done wrong, I'm sure they'll look into it.
All right, fair enough, Deena. We appreciate you talking about that. I want to talk to you about Sisolak's phase one. What are your thoughts on this? And I've heard, you know, different opinions on when these casinos are going to open, that the governor might not have the authority anymore, that it might be the gaming commission. Your thoughts on phase one as a whole, and what do you think about these casinos and the gaming commission now more involved than ever?
Well, you know, the whole strip and downtown are in my district, so it's very strange to ride down there and see them all closed. I have great respect for Steve's policy, the governor. He has followed science and health advisors, not politics. And that was a hard decision for him to make because so much of the state depends on travel and tourism. But I think you have to be smart. Doing it in phases is the way to do it because you don't want to open everything up too quickly and have a relapse and have those numbers go up like they have in Georgia, for example, because people aren't going to want to come if they don't feel safe here, and that will make our recovery take longer and be more difficult and more expensive.
I agree with you. We have to do this in a safe, you know, effective way where people feel safe. I couldn't agree with you more. With that being said, you have a lot of information that maybe, you know, someone like me, the general public, they don't have. Do you have any sense of when we might see the first gambling casino open up in Las Vegas? Do you have any sense of when that might happen?
Well, I know that the big casinos have been working on their own plans. I've seen the Wynn plan, the MGM plan. Those will go before the Gaming Control Board, the Gaming Commission. I think that's appropriate. I think that workers have to be involved in that planning. Culinary is certainly going to have a place at the table. Steve has said that phase one will last through the end of the month. We won't be opening for Memorial Day weekend. But maybe after that, if our numbers stay flat, and they have flattened pretty regularly for the last couple of weeks, you can see it starting to open, hopefully, by 4th of July.
So, Congresswoman, in Nevada, there's roughly 400,000 that are unemployed, you know, due to this coronavirus pandemic.
Yeah.
And a lot of them are obviously, they work in the casino industry. Some of them have received their unemployment benefits that they were promised an extra $600 a week. Do you have any idea what percentage of Nevadans at this point have not received unemployment benefits?
I don't have that number, but I can tell you that they're working very hard to try to get those benefits out. And Nevada's not the only state experiencing this. We had an out-of-date computer system and never have seen such a flood of people claiming unemployment. It's just put so much pressure on the system. But in the bill that we passed at the federal level, there was funding for the states to hire more people and upgrade, and that's what we've done. So the people are starting to get their benefits. And the main thing to realize, if they get frustrated, and we get about 100 calls in our office every day about this and small business loans, is that once you get it, and I know you need it now, it is retroactive. It doesn't just start at that point forward. It goes back to the beginning of your unemployment. So you're not losing that money. And now just this week, they've rolled out the rules for how if you're on the gig economy or a contractor or self-employed, you can start to apply and get the funding. Never in the past have those people qualified for it because they don't pay into that system, but now they will also get the benefits. And it's just a matter of having enough people on the phone, getting that computer system up and running. We've appropriated the money. It is there. The $600 extra on top of the unemployment you get from the state and the extended period of time. That's not going away. It's just the mechanics of getting it out. And I know the governor's office has made this a priority.
If you're just joining us, she is Congresswoman Dina Titus, representing us right here very well in the state of Nevada. Now, speaking of money, Dina, let's talk a little bit about something you've been working on, and a lot of people have. That is this $3 trillion CARES Act that just passed. Can you talk to us a little bit about that, and what does this mean for your constituents, those here in Nevada?
Yes, we passed the first CARES Act just several weeks ago. It seems like an eternity now. And that puts the original $1,200 in everybody's pocket and set up that unemployment system that I just described, and also set up a system for small businesses to get grants to, they call it a loan, but you don't have to pay it back, so it's in effect a grant, to keep people on the payroll and cover their health insurance. This bill that we went back and passed just last week is more about long-term sustainability. It's called the HEROES Act, and it's aimed at heroes on the front line. Healthcare workers, firefighters, policemen, and teachers are all essential employees. And so we've created an essential workers hazardous pay fund that has $200 billion in it. There's $75 billion for testing and tracing, which is what we need so we can track this virus, and that will help us to open up sooner. There are also some OSHA requirements for people who are in these hazardous positions so that they know that they're safe to go to work. There's the more direct payments for individuals that come straight to them, another $2,000 a person. There's some housing assistance. We hear a lot about that here in Las Vegas, need assistance with rent and mortgages. That's in that bill. And then the biggest chunk of it is to go to state and local governments to make up for what they've had to spend on the virus and also lost revenue. Because if you think about Nevada without sales tax or gaming tax, our budgets are going to just be crashing. The state's already talking about 4% cut across the board. They're using the rainy day fund. The city and the county are talking about cuts of $1 billion at the county, the school district, the university. So that money will help to make up some of that lost revenue.
You mentioned the rainy day fund, which was roughly $401 million for the state of Nevada. And Governor Sisolak did just announce, and last week, a fiscal state of emergency was declared. But he did announce that will be, drained, as you stated. Where will that money be going specifically?
Well, they will use it to fill some holes in the provision of essential services. You know, the state covers a lot of the Medicaid, a lot of the education money, some of the highway infrastructure money, prison system. I'm sure that his whole staff is looking at where the most critical points are, and he'll work with the legislature to use the money for that. There have been times when there's more money in the rainy day fund, less money in the rainy day fund. This is exactly the kind of situation that you have that fund for, to help you when things go bad.
Absolutely. I want to ask you about Joe Biden, but before I do that, I just want to go back to one other thing that you mentioned because I think it's really important. There are some casinos in Vegas that are planning on opening at the end of this month. So you had stated, and correct me if I'm wrong, that you think it's a possibility that maybe July 4th could be the date, which would mean, obviously, these casinos wouldn't be open in June. Is that kind of your timeline? And I'm not trying to pinpoint you to give an exact date here, but you said July 4th. Is there any chance? Because some people think that some of these casinos will be opening up later this month. But from what I'm hearing from you, it doesn't sound like that's going to happen. Is that a fair assessment?
Well, you're seeing them open in phases. And when I say July 4th, that's just the next big holiday and, kind of landmark. I don't have any reason to believe that's any kind of official date. I just think that'll be the next holiday we look toward. But you are already seeing some of the casinos opening up restaurants inside the casinos. And then you see some of them now, they're going to give free parking. They're going away from that paid parking. So I think they're rolling it out little at a time. When they'll be open and operating to the extent that we're used to, I don't know. You've seen some casinos in Arizona already start to open up with special, you can't do slot machines right next to each other, and you spread out the tables and all. So I think we just need to trust the industry. You got some of the best minds working on this. They're working with the regulators. They're working with Steve, who's working with healthcare officials. I think they're going to be smart about it because they know that the future hangs on getting people to come back to Las Vegas. We're resilient. We've done it before. And one of the things I got in the bill was some funding to, we're back in business advertising like they did along the Gulf when they had that big oil spill. Come back. The Gulf is back. Maybe we can use some of that economic development money to say, come back to Las Vegas. But people have to be sure that they're going to be safe or they won't want to come back.
And there was a commercial release recently that looked pretty good. I have a question about the Western States Pact. So California, Colorado, Washington, Oregon, and Nevada get involved in this pact. Within a couple of weeks, the request for $1 trillion from the federal government takes place. What exactly is this pact supposed to do? And should we expect Nevada to open up at the same timeline as California? Or how are we connected according to this pact?
Well, I think it's very smart that we're working with the other states in the region. And the governor has been working with Governor Inslee in Washington and Newsom in California, because you know this virus doesn't know a boundary. It could easily travel from Los Angeles up here when somebody comes for the weekend. So I think what they're trying to do is maybe coordinate some of the tracing of where the virus is, or who's opening up when, use of money for regional projects. So I think it's a good idea that we're part of that coalition.
Congresswoman, I wanted to ask you one more question in regards to Joe Biden. Obviously, I know you support the vice president. Latest polls that have come out are showing him leading, at least in most of the polls throughout the country, when it comes to him, of course, versus the president right now, Donald Trump. Listen, I thought Hillary was going to defeat Trump in 2016. I was wrong. A lot of people were wrong on that. How much do you think we should look at these polls and be confident on it? Because a lot of people were confident that Hillary was going to defeat Trump. And what do you make of these latest polls, and how much should we look into that and look at it as fact?
Well, you know, everybody says the poll is just a snapshot in time, and the poll that counts is the one that's taken on election day. It's encouraging to see those figures because I think it reflects that people around the country are seeing this president is just having no leadership at the federal level in this virus. Every day he goes on TV and says something just outrageous, like now he's taking the malaria drug. Half the people believe him and think that's bad. Half the people don't believe him, think it's a lie. Either way, it's not a good thing. So I think people are seeing Joe Biden as a leader. He's going to work very hard for every vote, though. We're working hard in Nevada. There are a lot of phone banks going on, a lot of telemeetings. I've been on some and with women in New York. He's doing a lot more social media. It's just changed the whole way you do campaigns. But, you don't go out there and kiss babies and shake hands in a situation like this. I think people respect the way he's doing it.
Oh, I do too, Dina. And I'll tell you what, we certainly respect you and the way you're doing things for us here in Nevada. You do a fantastic job, and I really mean that. I always thought that about you, and we always appreciate when you take some time to join us. Congresswoman Dina Titus, thank you so much for your time.
Well, thank you. Let's stay in touch.
Thank you. Appreciate that. Always does a fantastic job. I really do appreciate her, Congresswoman Dina Titus.